Well, let us go ahead and begin our program. Before we begin the formal aspect of the program, I'd like to recognize the many important sponsors who have made this very special evening possible. So in our slides, Mary Beth, if you can show that, our gold level sponsors, our silver level sponsors, as well as our diamond level sponsors. And we're extremely grateful to each of them for their strong support of TAMEST. I want to just kind of reflect back in the early part of 2000, when we first, as a group of presidents, met with Senator Kay Bailey Hutchison. God, I hope that's not my beeper. It's an Amber Alert. Okay. It's probably Senator Hutchison, probably. But anyhow, in those early years, it was Senator Hutchison's leadership who asked a group of presidents, what can we do to position Texas in a better place to capture more of the federal research dollars that, you know, Texas should be getting? And then how can we attract, not only recruit, but retain outstanding faculty members? So even though Senator Hutchison isn't here, she's with us in spirit, and I want to personally thank her for her leadership. TAMEST promotes broader recognition of our state's top achievers in medicine, engineering, and science, and builds a stronger identity for Texas as an important destination and center of achievement in these fields. Today, we experienced some of that great talent in the state of Texas as we heard their presentations. But the other important aspect of TAMEST is really to foster the next generation of leaders. And I'm so grateful that TAMEST has a protege program that allows many proteges to become a part of TAMEST. And then also for the most important recognition, which is really to recognize our outstanding stars who are now recipients of the Edith and the Peter O'Donnell Award. So congratulations, recipients. Now, it's also very important also for us to recognize donors of the TAMEST Endowment and the O'Donnell Endowment, and many of them are in attendance with us tonight. Jeff Kadosky, Jeff, thank you very much. To James Truchard with National Instruments, again, also thank you very much. As well as Texas Instruments Foundation, Luigi Colombo is here from Texas Instruments, and we're very, very grateful. There are also a variety of dignitaries. Each and every one of you are dignitaries, but there are certain members that should be highlighted. The first are our university presidents and chancellors who are in attendance, Richard Benson from UT Dallas, Ron DePino from UT MD Anderson, Greg Fenves from the University of Texas at Austin, and Ted Mitchell, our Texas Tech Health Science Center president. We have two outstanding Nobel laureates with us tonight, Robert Curl from Rice University and Johann Deisenhofer from UT Southwestern. And also Cindy Conroy is with us from the Governor's University Research Initiative Advisory Board, as well as several past TAMEST presidents, which include Ken Arnold, Lynn Draper, Steve Holditch, Betty Sue Masters, Don Paul, and I'll include myself in that group. So with that, I'd also like to recognize past O'Donnell Award recipients in attendance. Those are Brendan Lee from Baylor College of Medicine, Timothy Nedwed from ExxonMobil Upstream Research Company, and James Walker from the Southwest Research Institute. So with that now, let me introduce Dr. Ron DePino, who will preside over the awards ceremony. I was most fortunate to be Chancellor of the University of Texas System when we were able to recruit Ron DePino to come to the great state of Texas and to lead MD Anderson. It has been nothing but a joy for me to see your leadership and to see your faculty and your healthcare professionals take such great care of patients not only in Texas but from around the world, and not only to make it a great hospital where patients have the comfort of knowing that they have the most outstanding care, but also now a great, great, great research institution, especially with your moonshots, Ron, that in our lifetime, we're seeing great progress in making cancer history, and I attribute a lot of that to your leadership and that of your great faculty and staff. Thank you.
Now that was one of the greatest chancellors in the greatest state and the greatest nation. This man here, when you think about his tenure at the University of Texas as chancellor, two new medical schools, that alone was an enormous accomplishment. The impact of the university throughout the nation and the world is largely due to your vision. And we are very grateful for your leadership. Let's give it up for Chancellor Sigurota. Now, this great state really derives from the excellence of its people, and it's my privilege to introduce this coveted award. So the Edith and Peter O'Donnell Awards recognizes outstanding achievements of young investigators in medicine, engineering, science, and technology innovation. The awards play a very important role in elevating awareness of TAMEST's goal of trying to elevate our research and the excellence of our research here and around the world. The awards are named in honor of Edith and Peter, who've been incredible supporters of TAMEST since its inception, but also have been major advocates for research and education throughout this great state in many different ways. There isn't a single educational initiative of higher education and research that their hand has not been involved in. They are true pillars, along with Senator Hutchinson, in helping to drive the excellence and the talent of this amazing community. Through the O'Donnell Foundation, Edith and Peter have worked relentlessly to help Texas reach the educational level needed for us to succeed in the 21st century. Now, each O'Donnell Award recipient will be introduced by a video highlighting their incredible work, followed by remarks of the nominator or introducer, and finally, brief remarks from each award recipient. So I'm now going to introduce the nominators. Dr. Susan Rosenberg from one of the great medical schools in the United States, Baylor College of Medicine, speaking on behalf of nominator Dr. Hooter Zogby. Susan, please stand. Thank you. We have then Dr. Sharon Wood from UT Austin speaking on behalf of nominator Nick Pepis. Thank you. And we have Dan Jaffe of UT Austin speaking on behalf of Dan Jaffe. How good is that? Okay, so now let's see the first video of a truly gifted scientist, Dr. Meng Wang.
Being a scientist, we should be fearless. We should not be afraid. We are always on the frontier to discover unknown. And if you are always hold back by your fear, and how can you make new things and make new discoveries? My name is Meng Wang. I'm currently an associate professor at Baylor College of Medicine. My main research focus is on aging biology, why some people age much better than other people. Between 2014 and 2050, the percentage of the population at age 60 and above will be doubled from 11 to 22%. Aging is a major risk factor for many chronic and degenerative diseases like, you know, Alzheimer's, cardiovascular disorders, and cancer.
Meng is a bright, wonderful, passionate scientist. Her curiosity tends to be about problems that are really important for general health.
In elementary school, I realized my dad looked much younger than his real age. My dad at that time worked in a city quite far away. And so, you know, when he came back home, he liked to pick me up at school. but people don't see him very often, right? So every time they say, oh, your big brother is here, kind of make me always wonder, what's the magic? My grandma is exactly the same way. Unfortunately, she passed away a few years ago when she was 100 years old, but with no dementia, no chronic diseases. That's my main inspiration to be a scientist. We are investigating new natural compound that we can use to promote longevity, not necessarily lifespan extension, but more importantly, health span extension.
She's always been interested in healthy aging and interested in understanding how metabolism and various cellular functions affect that.
One area we are very interested is metabolic product. They are the natural compound that existing in our body. We think they are the natural compound that we can use to boost our health. We have been developing a lot of new technology platforms to visualize those molecules in live cells, in live organisms.
Having been trained in a wonderful lab that studies the worm C. elegans, she found a great opportunity now to address questions she's passionate about.
We are using really cutting-edge technologies using C. elegans as model organism. We are one of the few biology labs that are using this technology.
She teaches us a lot about how to do good science.
I try to give them space and importantly protect their scientific curiosity.
She doesn't tell us exactly what to do, but if we're deviating, she gently nudges us along in the right direction.
Personally, I don't have a desire to live to what, 300 years, but I really want my later life can be like my grandma's, you know, active, healthy, independent, and meaningful.
Terrific. Well, as one who has just traversed the plus 60 divide, I'm extremely grateful. Here to say a few words, Susan. Thank you.
Well, excuse me. My colleague Huda Zoghbi couldn't be here tonight, but it is an honor to be her substitute. It is a tremendous pleasure to introduce Meng Wang to you, my colleague at Baylor College of Medicine. She is an associate professor of molecular and human genetics and the Robert C. Fife Endowed Faculty Scholar in the Huffington Center on Aging. Meng is really a brilliant creative innovator and pioneer who's discovering how molecules produced by our bodies, by metabolism, can counteract aging and promote healthful longevity. This work is important, very important to the diseases that accompany aging in people, like cancer and neurodegenerative diseases. For those of you who were here this morning and heard Marsha McNutt's presentation and saw the distribution of ages in the United States that we're facing, you will know that this kind of work is very important for our future. Meng came to Baylor College of Medicine in 2010 from Gary Rufkin's lab at Harvard Medical School. Both before and since, she's really made fundamental breakthroughs in both the technology and also the biology of lipid metabolism and aging. So, for example, Meng developed biophysical methods that let you see lipids inside of living cells and also inside of living whole organisms without labeling them. Her method is much more specific than previous methods. It's a whole lot better for a lot of things. Her lab used these kind of technologies to discover a large number of proteins that can counteract aging and promote healthful longevity. She did this work in worms, you saw, C. elegans, but these proteins are highly conserved, they're the same, and the pathways are similar in humans, and so these are relevant for our health. Meng discovered a wholly new mechanism that promotes healthful longevity, and how it works is that sort of the garbage incinerator of the cell, the lysosome, degrades fats, and it takes one of those degradation products and sends it into the nucleus where that lipid can help to activate and turn on genes that counteract aging. This work, the whole lot of it, is leading to a lot of very promising directions, including one that Meng mentioned in her video, the potential development of natural molecules as so-called nutraceuticals, molecules that could be used to therapeutically inhibit the deleterious effects of aging. So Meng is completely a star, as well as a wonderful colleague. Since she came to Baylor, she's won a truckload of awards, and I'll just tell you about a few of them. She won the Ellison Medical Foundation New Scholar Award. She was awarded by the American Society for Cell Biology the Emerging Leader Prize. Just last year, 2016, she was recognized by the Glenn Award for Biological Mechanisms in Aging. She she was named a Kavli Frontiers in Science Fellow. She won a Howard Hughes Medical Institute Faculty Scholar Award and the NIH Director's Pioneer Award. We are so proud of Meng and delighted of her receipt of the Edith and Peter O'Donnell Award in Medicine. Meng, please.
Thank you, Susan, for this very, very kind introduction. It's my big honor to receive the Edith and Peter O'Donnell Award this year. I'm really humbled to be recognized together with other outstanding O'Donnell Award recipients. So first, thanks to O'Donnell Foundation and the selection committee for selecting me, and also TAMEST for organizing such exciting event. So as a basic biologist, I think I truly share their belief that advances in fundamental science will have a long-lasting impact on everyone's life and will transform and brighten our future. So I think this recognition will be a big motivation for me and young scientists at Texas to push science forward and to make our society better. And secondly, I want to thank all the current and former members in my lab. I'm really fortunate to work with this bright and energizing young scientist. And you know, for a person who studies aging, I think getting their inspiration you know, from their passion, their curiosity every day is the best way to stay young. So as Susan mentioned, I joined Baylor in 2010. So during these 6 years, a lot of candidates asked me the same question again and again. What's the best part of being at Baylor? My answer is always the people, especially my amazing colleagues. So Dr. Huda Zaghabi nominated me for this award. Unfortunately, she could not join us today. So thanks her and Susan for their continuous encouragement and support. They're really my role models as a women scientist. Also, thanks my three chairs, Dr. Art Baudet, Dr. Brandon Lee, and Dr. Hui Zheng, for their belief in me and my science and giving me all the space and the freedom to develop my own research programs. And thanks all my wonderful colleagues to build such a collaborative and fun environment to do and enjoy science. And like any long journey, the start of a scientific career really paved the road for the future. So I'm very lucky to have two incredible mentors during my training. So my PhD advisor, Dr. Dirk Bowman, and my postdoc mentor, Dr. Gary Rafkin. So thank them for teaching me how to do science, and more importantly, how to be a scientist. Last but not least, thanks my dear family. So thanks my grandma and my dad for giving me the inspiration at the first place to become aging biologist. And thanks my mom for teaching me being strong and independent. Hopefully I got a good genes from my grandma and my dad. And thanks my dear husband, Fan Xia, for his unconditional support of my scientific dream, for always believing in me more than myself. And thank you, my son Alves, for your unconditional love and for your appreciation to have very busy scientist mom. So to create a better tomorrow for you and for all the children, I think is ultimate goal of my research, and I think for all the scientists. Thank you.
Alpus, why don't you come up here? I think you should come up here. I think you should put this on mom. Your mom is awesome. Why don't you put this on your mom? That was great. So if you ever need a job, just call me in about 10 years. The next video is about a really gifted engineer, Dr. Andrew Dunn. Please watch the video.
My whole life, I've been interested in building things, figuring out how things work. My grandfather could build anything. There was nothing he couldn't do. Having that ability to create was something that I always aspired to. There have been times where I'm working in the garage, designing something, and I'll have ideas about something at work. My name's Andrew Dunn, and I'm a professor of biomedical engineering at UT Austin. My lab builds custom microscopes for studying how the brain works and how the neurons communicate with one another. I was first introduced to lasers through my father, who was a type 1 diabetic. He would go into the hospital and have laser surgery on his eyes. To me, lasers seemed like some things out of a science fiction movie. And it was just fascinating to me that they could actually be used to treat people. We're trying to study how the brain repairs itself after an injury like a stroke.
He has developed this magnificent laboratory and exceptional research. As the blood flows in the brain, he can see where the blood has started creating clots.
In a traditional medical image, like an X-ray, the doctor sees a static picture. In the imaging techniques that we develop, we're able to track the changes in the brain to better diagnose tissue as they're operating, which will ultimately lead to improved healthcare for people.
What Andy has been able to do is to use optical techniques to really see the very early stages of clots in the brain.
The ability to visualize blood flow during neurosurgery in real time allows the surgeon to easily identify areas that have potentially have reduced blood flow.
Doing it continuously as the blood flows on the surface of the brain gives us the opportunity to image, to see where clots first develop.
If those areas are not identified and they're potentially treatable, they oftentimes won't show up until several days later where the patient suffers a stroke.
Our lab is at the intersection of physics and neuroscience. What we're trying to do is figure out what actually goes on in the vasculature, in your blood vessels at the deep biological level, what's happening and how can we correct it faster and better.
I'm very passionate about teaching, working with students, seeing them develop as engineers and scientists is probably the most rewarding aspect of my job.
He's all about the big picture, which I appreciate. It gives me a lot of purpose and meaning to know that we're trying to solve the big issues.
Now that we have taken the first steps into the clinic, I think we're beginning to scratch the surface. I think we're going to make enormous strides in how much we understand about the brain. The imaging technologies will play a major role in unraveling how the brain actually works.
Here to say a few words, Dr. Sharon Wood.
Good evening, everyone. I am really pleased to be here tonight to introduce Andy Dunn, who is one of my outstanding colleagues in the Cockrell School of Engineering at the University of Texas at Austin. His work in biomedical engineering and the dedication he has shown to his profession have embodied performance, creativity, and resourcefulness, the essential elements of this distinguished award. Throughout Andy's career, which has spanned two decades and taken him from California Irvine to the Harvard Medical School to UT Austin, he has been an innovator in the field of imaging, and his contributions have had a major impact on society. As you saw in the video, Andy's major research focus has been development of novel optical imaging techniques for use in the brain. The multi-exposure speckle imaging technique, which was developed in his lab for the dynamic imaging of cerebral blood flow, has been primarily impactful. As the first engineer to introduce the use of multiple camera exposures to enable the high-resolution imaging of blood flow, Andy was able to create a platform that could visualize and quantify blood flow in real time during neurosurgery. This has generated tremendous interest in both clinics and industry, and has created a whole new set of directions in chronic stroke studies. Over the past decade, the technique has been adopted by many leading neuroscience researchers, and Andy has personally helped more than a dozen other labs adopt the technology for their own work. The winner of a National Institutes of Health Career Development Award, a National Science Foundation Career Award, a University of Texas Systems Regents Outstanding Teaching Award, and an American Heart Association Established Investigator Award, Andy is a highly accomplished leader who has established a reputation for excellence within the engineering and medical communities. At UT Austin, he has been a model research collaborator and has forged strong strategic partnerships to maximize the collective impact of our research and apply new technologies to neurosurgery. Please join me in congratulating Andy Dunn, the recipient of the Edith and Peter O'Donnell Award in Engineering.
Thank you, Dean Wood, for that nice introduction. And thank you to all the members of TAMEST and, of course, the TAMEST Awards Committee. It's really an honor to be receiving this award. I'd also like to thank the O'Donnell family and O'Donnell Foundation for making this award possible. And first, I'd like to thank all the members of my lab, all the graduate students and postdocs who've spent so many hours in the lab really doing all of the hard work. And also the many undergraduates who have really made significant contributions to our work. Now, I've been very fortunate to have tremendous support at UT Austin, from UT Austin, from the Cockrell School of Engineering, especially from my former dean, now President Fenves, and current dean, Dean Wood. Really, they have gone out of their way to make our work possible. I've also been very fortunate to have a number of really excellent mentors, several of whom are members of TAMEST themselves. Rebecca Richards-Cordham, my PhD advisor. But I'd especially like to thank Nicholas Pepis, who's been a wonderful colleague and mentor over the years, who's really also been a role model for what it means to be a great scientist and engineer. And finally, I'd like to thank my family. I'm very fortunate to have my mother here, and also my wife, Mary, and daughters, Malin and Allie, here. Really, without their support and love and constant encouragement, I certainly wouldn't be here today. So thank you again.
And now we'll see a great video of Dr. Daniel Bolnick's amazing contributions.
Being in the outdoors is just a profoundly relaxing experience for me. It's a place where I get to pay attention to the diversity of life around me. And doing that is a great form of inspiration for scientific questions. My name is Dr. Daniel Bolnick. I'm a professor of integrative biology at the University of Texas at Austin. I think I've been brought outdoors by my parents since I was a toddler. They like to tell the story of my first hike when I was two. I covered about 2.5 miles, and they fueled me entirely with Tootsie Rolls, placed at strategic intervals along the trail, and I've been hooked ever since, although I don't use the Tootsie Rolls anymore. From ninth grade on, I knew I wanted to be not just a biologist, but I wanted to be a biologist studying organisms in their natural environment.
Being out in the natural world must influence your thinking and must provide you with new insights that you don't get just sitting at your desk or being in a lab. He was working at the intersection of ecology and evolution.
One of the most striking things that you come across is the diversity of life. How did that get to be here? And why are they so different from each other? How do they coexist with each other? Those are the kinds of questions that I'm interested in. I want to know, how did life come to be so diverse? How does it stay so diverse? And why does that diversity matter? We study a small fish called the three-spined stickleback up in Canada, and we happen to notice some parasites, but only in some places. Some fish would have them, some fish wouldn't, even though it's all the same species of fish. You go 2 kilometers away, and there's not a single fish out of thousands that have this parasite. How do they do that? And so we've been studying the genetics and the immunology of how certain populations of fish manage to eliminate this parasite. But the parasites fight back. And they fight back by shutting off their host's immune system. If we know how they do that, we can figure out how to turn off our own immunity when we need to do so.
It's this synthesis of these two areas of ecology and evolution that has enabled him to open up a whole new area.
People suffer a great variety of immune disorders. Allergies, Crohn's disease, colitis. It's our own immune system attacking our own cells. And if we can figure out how to dial that back or dial that up, that can be very useful for us.
Understanding how those dynamics play out would hopefully benefit people in the development of better vaccines and better anti-helminic drugs, those kind of things.
This environment that he's created for himself is really rich and ripe for the possibilities of discovery.
Ultimately, it's that curiosity that both gives you ideas and that makes you stick with it.
He's really broken new ground across a very broad field that has a lot of impact.
Dan has been a great mentor for me. He's given a lot of free rein to think and come up with interesting questions and to explore those pathways.
I'm happy that my work has consequences. Ultimately, I get up in the morning because I'm curious and I want to know an answer. You don't know what answer you're going to get, and you get this huge rush when you find something surprising that you weren't anticipating.
Dr. Daniel Jaffe.
Thank you. excuse my voice today. It's not reflective of what was in the film. I'm sorry to disappoint you. I got to know Dan Bolnick in 2008 when he was a Packard Fellow, and at the time I heard him talk about his work, and I was struck mostly by the idyllic nature of his field work, the canoes and the beautiful Canadian lakes and things like that. But really, I should have paid more attention. Here was somebody who was a graduate student, had published a Nature paper based on a box of fruit flies on his desk. It only gets better from there. So that was really a great start. Since receiving his PhD at the University of California, Davis in 2003 and taking up his position at the University of Texas at Austin, where he's now a professor of integrative biology. He's earned significant recognition for his groundbreaking work across the boundaries of evolution, ecology, and immunology. His papers are among the most cited in multiple fields, and his work has stimulated several conferences. He's examined the complex interplay between intraspecific trait variation, both in phenotype and behavioral variation and ecological dynamics. I had a chance to speak to him for about a half an hour before the dinner tonight, and one of the areas that I told him fascinated me about what he does is he tells me is just a sidelight, which is his work on the microbiota in his fish, where he's looked in the fish and in other species, an individual diet and its sex-dependent effects on gut microbiota. So on the ecology of the insides of these larger organisms. And it makes me kind of think of a genetics ecology Russian doll, where you're studying the ecology of the outside and then you study the ecology of the inside. And there's fascinating problems to think about. And it's just amazing that he's managed to put all this together in a field that's been around for a long time. This display of original thinking is truly remarkable. One of his mentors writes, he's a once-in-a-generation scientist and is one of the top evolutionary ecologists in the world. And I think the film that you've seen and the work that he's done and the recognition that he's got and the reach that he's had over his great field has really amply demonstrated this. So it's a pleasure to introduce Dan Bolnick.
I very much like the Russian doll analogy. That works well. Well, I often tell my students when they're speaking or writing that they shouldn't use the phrase needless to say, because you shouldn't have to say it. But needless to say, thank you to TAMEST, the committee that organizes the awards, to the Peter and Edith O'Donnell Foundation, and to them for the support. And there's a long list of other people that need thanking, ranging from mentors, going back, and I want to particularly actually call out my public school teachers from K through 12. I had an amazing set of teachers. I went to public school in Massachusetts, and I was writing in every class, writing research papers, and the intensity of real support for independent thinking and writing at that level, I think, is just fantastic and something that needs to be really inherent in how we approach education generally. I had the good luck then to go to Williams College in Massachusetts, which again, a small liberal arts school, very writing, very independent, very research focused, and just a fantastic environment to be in. And that led me ultimately into graduate school, where I had, again, fantastic mentors. I had faculty pay for page charges who weren't even responsible for me. I wasn't working with them. They're just like, hey, yeah, that was great, here. One of the things that happens in evolution and ecology that I think is really special as a discipline is a habit of letting students work on fundamentally their own questions, often wildly unrelated to those of the mentors. As long as the mentor is capable of providing feedback and advice, there's a real feeling that one needs to set out on developing your very own niche very early on, and that's a really supportive environment. It's challenging to do, of course, but I think that culture at UC Davis and elsewhere was a fantastic way to develop. And then ultimately, I need to thank my parents, who indeed brought me outside. They took me hiking in the White Mountains in Hampshire with Tootsie Rolls at age 2. That was true. And brought me all around the world growing up. We lived in Indonesia. We lived in Central Africa. And the biological diversity I encountered really was an inspiration. And I set out to understand that diversity. I spent a few years in Peace Corps in Tanzania after college, and I went scuba diving in the Great Lakes in East Africa, and I was wowed by thousands of species of fish. And I set out not to fix aging or to understand vasculature in the brain. Those are much more useful things than what I aim to do. I really just want to understand why life is diverse. and that diversity plays out at the level of species. It plays out at the level of individual to individual variation. And that's really where I got interested. Evolutionary biology is the raison d'etre of personalized medicine. We are different from each other, and we need different treatments because evolution creates diversity. Lastly, I want to thank my fantastic wife, who's put up with all sorts of shenanigans from capturing, she helps me catch fish in Canada once, and she said, no more of that. and I paid her back by helping her extract DNA from people's blood for a while in grad school. And then ultimately my two daughters, age 5 and 8, who we let stay at home tonight because it's a late night and they have school tomorrow morning. But somebody once told me that insanity is inherited, you get it from your kids. And I'd say, I'd revise that to say curiosity is inherited, you get it from your kids. Their curiosity about the world, their enthusiasm for science, my 5-year-old recognizes the structure of DNA when she sees it, is just infectious, and it's a great joy to be able to cultivate that. Thank you.
Take a shot here.
Chancellor Sigaroa.
Well, what a wonderful evening listening to what Meng and Andrew and Daniel are doing. This is an evening that I look forward to every year to attend the Edith and Peter O'Donnell Award ceremony, and tonight only reinvigorates my desire to come to this special evening every year. And my heart is full of joy and pride for the great talent that is in this great state of Texas, advancing science and really improving the quality of life, not only for our citizens in this great state, but for people from around the world. So let's give them another great round of applause. I also want to again thank all the donors who make this evening possible. You know, all these videos and all the great support that we provide for our recipients does require funding. So if you desire, don't hesitate to give a little pledge towards TAMEST to continue to support, you know, our great talent in the state. We're going to be able to hear more about the great science that our Edith and Peter O'Donnell recipients tomorrow. During tomorrow's sessions, and I'm looking very much forward to that as well. So breakfast is going to be served tomorrow at 7:45, and then the meeting will begin promptly at 8:45. And I also want to take this moment to thank Mary Beth and all the members of the TAMEST staff for really putting forth a great, you know, program today. Mary Beth, if you and your staff could please stand up. And finally, I'd like to ask the O'Donnell Award recipients and their nominators and Dr. DePino to please stay so that we can take multiple photos of this great evening. Thank you. Thank you very much.